This is Karen Kuniyuki with the Emmanuel School of Fine Arts. This video lesson is about digital photography for the beginner photographer. I'm going to explain four very simple rules that you can follow that will elevate your photography skills and your results to a whole new level. For this lesson, you're going to need some kind of digital camera. For all the pictures you'll see in this video, I used my iPhone. You can use a point-and-shoot camera that you later download photos onto your computer with. You could also use a tablet, or you could just use a smartphone. The first rule is to pay attention to how you compose your photo and don't chop off anything important. And what I mean by this is pay close attention to hands and feet and heads when you're photographing people, as well as animals, and scenery where you have to make a decision of where the photograph is going to end. In my example here, my son is playing in the water, and I've gotten down to his level. In the foreground, there are tadpoles in the water. That might not be obvious to you, but he remembers that from our day together, and when he sees the picture, he'll remember that the tadpoles are in the foreground. I've made sure to include almost all of his head, both hands, and both feet. You'll notice that the person in the background has been chopped in half. You only see their legs. But since they're far enough in the background and the background is blurry, that's okay. The subject of my photo is the boy right in the front, and all of his arms and legs and his head are included in the picture. The second rule is to explore your subject from different points of view. Whenever you approach something that you want to photograph, think about looking at it from your perspective, and then maybe a dog's perspective, or maybe a bird's eye view from above, or a worm's eye view from way down low. Walk around your subject if possible, fully around it, 360 degrees, and try to decide which angle is the most flattering for the picture, and where is your light source the best. In my example here, I have a pool of water from a creek bed, and I photographed the pool of water from above, which makes the water look very beautiful, bluish-green colors, and I can see the details of the algae in the water. And then I have a second photograph of the same pool that's taken much closer to the level of the water. It's also taken with the sunlight coming from a different direction, and it looks like a completely different location. The third rule is to take your time and to make sure that the subject of your photo, what you want us to look at, the object in the photo that is the most important to you, is in focus. Don't rush this process. Keep in mind that certain things are really hard to get into focus. Insects like butterflies and birds, they will move very quickly, and it's hard to get them into focus. If it's a windy day, flowers and grasses will bend and blow in the breeze, and that will also become very difficult to get into focus. One example I have here is a marshmallow that somebody toasted, and just before popping it in their mouth, they saw a heart shape, and they held it out to me. And I took the picture, but I only took one picture, and later when we got home, we saw that the marshmallow was not in focus. Sad panda. The second example I have for you is a poppy flower. And on the left side of the screen, the poppy was blowing in the breeze and the camera focused accidentally on the grass. In the second picture on the right-hand side, I was able to tap on the poppy flower and capture it right when the poppy flower was open. And I got a pretty clear shot of the poppy and all of the inside details. You have to be patient, and you're going to need to take more than one picture of your subject to get it sharp and crisp the way you want it. The last rule I'm going to give you today is to pay attention to your light source and use it to your advantage, whatever that light source may be. If you're outside, chances are your light source is going to be the sun. If you're inside, the light source might be a lamp, or it may be natural light coming in from a window. Always acknowledge where your light is coming from and see what it looks like. The first example I have for you is a creek. It was that little pool of water that I was photographing earlier. And in this case, it's very bright in the afternoon, and I've chosen to have the sun filter through the leaves of the trees. If I didn't have the sun filtering through the trees, it would just be a big, huge ball of light in my picture, and all the color would be lost in my picture. So I used the tree to block the sun, and I got beautiful highlight details in the leaves and some sparkles in the water. Now, when I took this picture, on my phone, I tapped on the waterfall in the background. That told my phone to focus on the waterfall and adjust the exposure for the rock in the water that was in the darkest area of the picture. If I had tapped on the tree with the sun coming through the tree, you would not have been able to see the waterfall in the background. So play with your camera and play with the light and tap on different areas of your composition to see how your camera adjusts to the quality of light in your picture. The next example I have for you is a cactus. And the yellow cactus was taken in full sun in the afternoon, and it's extremely bright. And there aren't very many shadowy details in it because the sun is blowing out all of those shadows and highlights. In the right-hand side picture of the orangey cactus, I used my body to create a shadow. So I stood between the sun and the flower, casting a shadow over the flower. And then I made sure that the picture I was taking was completely within that shadow. And I tapped on my flower, telling my camera to make the exposure for the flower. This resulted in a very beautiful, even focus on the flower and a wide range of tones in that orange cactus bloom. You decide which you like better. Do you like the bright, sunshiny flower better, or do you like the cooler tones in the orange cactus flower? It's really a matter of personal preference. The third example for this rule is people. When you photograph people, you have to be very conscious of where the light is and what it does to the person's face. People will generally photograph much better if they're in shade or if there's something blocking the sun. You need the sun to light their face, but you want to eliminate harsh shadows because they're not very flattering. In this one picture of my family, we were on the edge of a cliff, an overlook, and I asked them all to look at me, but the sun was right over my shoulder. And when they looked at me, they were having a very hard time keeping their eyes open. And as a result, two people's eyes are closed in the picture and they're squinting really bad. In my second example, it's also very bright and sunshiny, but I've put the bright sunshine behind my sun. Then once again, I used my camera. I tapped on my son's face to focus on his face, but it also tells the camera to read the light from his face and to make the right adjustments. So I see his face really well, and then he has this really pretty halo effect from the light behind him reflecting off of the water. So always be conscious of where the sun is in relation to where the person is that you're trying to photograph. I hope you take these four tips and go play with your camera. The great thing about digital photography is that if the pictures don't come out well, you just delete them. You have no money spent and you can just retake them and practice over and over again. I hope you'll come back next time. My next photography lesson is going to talk about how to create a storyboard and be a photojournalist, where you tell a story using pictures. If you enjoyed this art lesson, please share it on social media with your friends and family and help us promote the Emmanuel School of Fine Arts. We look forward to sharing more art and music lessons with you in the near future, and we hope you come back. Bye!